Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the ESL 1 New York. It is the U.S. qualifier we're doing to find out who will be the last team to face up against Complexity to get that final spot to the LAN finals. Let's find out together. Currently, SNA have themselves a one-game advantage over top 5, having a rather convincing game, and well, that's a rather difficult thing to do on the current patch, but they're doing it rather well. And I guess a man who knows how to win on the current patch after he came off his 2-0 win earlier tonight is my co-caster, Pendago. Welcome to the broadcast.
Thanks for having me. Don't know if I've quite mastered the new patch yet, but
I don't think
like
anybody
think
will
have a good cert.
It'll take a couple of weeks, man. It'll take a couple of weeks. Maybe months. Give it time.
That'd be nice.
I'm looking forward to seeing its implications over at ESL 1. Because I feel like that's going to be the sweet spot. Like you've got your big lands this weekend, like the EMC is coming up this weekend. We've got some awesome games coming up as well through the WePlay matches, which begin tomorrow night, by the way, right here on Jodota Red at 20:30 EST, season 3 of WePlay has returned. Some great games in a very complicated but fun format coming up from that one. And then we got more matches coming up, the more D2CL, but it's only like on the 9th of October. You can do the countdown for this one, man. In 2 weeks, in 13 days,
Radiant Team,
we start the ESL 1 New York. In 13 days, is ESL 1 New York.
Dire team pick.
Yep. That's not going to give teams a lot of time to practice stuff, but it'll, like you said, that's going to be a good amount of time for teams to like get a good feel for it, but it'll still leave a lot of room for interesting things to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Especially since people are not going to train. I mean, I'm assuming people are going to be using a lot of stuff on that LAN. Like, they're not going to try and keep things secret, obviously. We're not saving strats for anything afterwards.
Not with ESL 1, because the next major event after ESL 1, you got 1 week. Actually, you got Starlight LAN finals 2 weeks after.
Oh.
They had the LAN finals then. And then there's DreamHack Bucharest. There's MSI Beta finals. DreamHack Bucharest is the D2CL finals. And then week after that, there's another major event, which is a world championship thing, which I actually probably shouldn't have said. But meanwhile,
spoilers.
Two weeks after that is DreamHack Winter. The week after that is the summit. The week after that is the WePlay LAN final. The week after, 2 weeks after that, there's a fun event down somewhere else, which I'm not supposed to mention.
Spoilers, we'll cut that out.
It's too early in the morning.
It's okay. I'm sure everyone knows that there's plenty of great Dota coming eventually, so that's all that matters.
I was looking for a placid start to the afternoon. Forgot there was a C9 versus Na'Vi game. Then Na'Vi actually forfeit because they couldn't get computers in time at EMC because their players also hadn't arrived yet to EMC. So they couldn't play their game. So I rushed in, I got all flustered, and then I spent 4 hours doing scheduling. And tell you now, that crap rots the brain.
Your hero got banned. That's surprising.
10 seconds
Your Drow Ranger.
With a VS and a Drow Ranger on the field, I wouldn't
Five
be as surprised.
Remaining.
It's uncommon. I would have actually looked more towards something like a Skywrath Reserve Mage.
Time.
With that vengeful spirit. Going up against a Brewmaster. Oh, he's already been taken out. I don't know what then would have been the selection. Because the VS, like, you see Cloud9 running that one. It's the VS, it's the Lyke, and it's the Drow, it's the Visage. And then you just have a really good, strong solo mid, which can either be the Viper or the Death Prophet. So kind of set in line.
Yeah.
But just the VS pickup, you're right. It's unusual just to ban the Drow because of that.
I think Sneaky Nyx Assassins has, I actually don't know if they've run in the past, but I'm sure they're very capable of running it. Wisp, nice. I like that hero. I think that hero's going to be pretty strong because of the new rune changes. It's going to open up, like, double bottling a lot. Like you were saying before, you can get on your mid, you can get off your off lane, and if it's really good for your support, which for a Wisp this game it is, even if you don't do, like, a dual mid lane, I still think going bottle and Wisp will be really good.
Would we be looking at what we saw early today in Starladder then, with this lineup too? Because you could technically run the Legion Commander as well.
Yeah, for sure.
It wasn't touched in this
series.
Very
possible. And Sneaking Assassins hasn't banned it yet, so I wouldn't be surprised.
I'm going to flag a really interesting stat so far for the matches tonight. Actually, I'm going to double check to see what's happening with the Dota 2 Canada Cup right now, just in case things have changed. Nope, things haven't changed. It's a 100% ban pick rate over on Terrorblade currently. And it's a 100% win rate on Terrorblade. Currently the only player to have played Terrorblade in a competitive Dota 2 game with a new patch, obviously, with only a few games being played, it's not really that big of an achievement, but Mikey is currently the only person who holds the record for a victory on Terrorblade. Congratulations, yeah. Mikey.
Yeah, that hero's crazy. Tiny. Alright, so they're going to go with the Wisp Tiny instead. I suppose they could still pick up Legion Commander if they wanted to, too, and have, like, the dual Wisp threat and have Wisp kind of run around and go between the lanes, but
With three melee heroes already, running three melee heroes up against a Faceless Void, Greed is one of them, and just being completely ineffective up against him is the other.
Yeah, that's true.
Even though Faceless Void was slightly crippled.
Yeah, it doesn't disable, so like Tiny's passive is going to be really great against Faceless Void in the Chronosphere now.
But they get a second answer. Like, they just get the Enigma, then pick up by it. So this will let them win, like, economy-wise early on. Radiant team ban. At the same time, though, does this actually kind of nerf Enigma with the way the hero gold is being dished out? We're gaining an economical advantage from the jungle. To get items like mech may make it really worth it, but after that point, he's got to start fighting. It might actually cancel, getting BKBs, and instead trying to force the Enigma into a more of an initiating role with a Blink Dagger first.
Reserve time. That's very possible, too, just because of the BKB charge changes and the fact that you can't get two. Even on Enigma, it's not very common that you would see it, like, ever get to a point where you'd be able to buy two BKBs, but...
Yeah. You just use your refresher anyway.
Yeah. I think you could still see Enigma's, like, potentially rushing BKB if they can take the fights early. But Blink, like, with the ability to pick off and the extra, like, farm it gives you, could still be good first. It just, obviously, you have to be really smart about using it. You can't just, like, blink in and be crazy. I was thinking about that new item. What's that new item called? Crimson Guard.
Yeah, Crimson Guard.
And it gives you... It's a buckler and a vanguard, and it turns into the thing, and it's a recipe too, like 800 gold. That could be an interesting item on Enigma, to be honest, because if he gets that item, he's actually... Like, that plus a Blink Dagger, he's really tanky and can... Like, the guy I played with in ESL, Bleak, like, he used to really love going heart, straight up heart on Enigma, and he would just, like, run into people and they couldn't do anything to him. You'd just, like, fight in Midnight Pulse and you could just summon Eidolons that stun people, and if you got it fast enough, like, because he's such a crazy early game farming hero, and to a lesser extent, he's just good at farming throughout the whole game, like, you couldn't fight the hero, but I think that item could be a good, like... replacement instead of the Vanguard. 5 seconds, but we'll see.
Just to establish what it does, as I bring it up on the side, ET appears from top 5. Nice. The item, it'll provide 250 life points, 6 HP regen, a passive damage block of 80% chance for 40/20 melee range, and then you've got plus 5 armor, plus 2 to all stats. The active guard gives nearby allied heroes 750 range plus in 750 range, plus 2 armor and a damage block shell that has a 100% chance to block 50 damage. Remaining. It lasts 9 seconds and a cooldown of 70. The passive damage block gives the wearer a chance to block damage from each incoming attack based on whether the equipped hero is melee or ranged. No guide on the effects heroes having the same thing as pipe, insight, and mechanism. Stacks 70 seconds.
That could be interesting. If you get that, like, on your Eidolons, they have to have the magic damage to kill them. And you can just really man fight people with them, but we'll see if people do that. I mean, I still think that mech, I think it's sort of going to be situational between mech and getting that item. It just depends on what the MA team's looking like. If it's a lot of magic teamfight damage, like what we saw last game from Sneaky Nyx Assassins, then I think mech would be better. But against the type of lineup that, like, has tons of right-click and maybe, like, Enigmas or Furions and tons of summons, that thing's going to be probably better than mech in most situations.
Well, these guys are quick getting their hero selected. We're already inside the game. So no mucking around in this game. And we get an Invoker as the last pickup here by Ush. How are you meant to pronounce his name? Because I'm saying Ush.
I think it's just Ush.
It's just Ush?
I always call him Ush. Yeah, I don't know. That's what I call him. That's what most people call him.
I always just wondered if it was meant to be like push, but like push, but you remove the P, so it's oosh. Oh, oosh.
I'll ask him.
Please do. I would like to know how to pronounce his name correctly. Whitebeard's a piece of cake. So is TC. And he's going to have some help from Derp Derp down the bottom lane while IX Mike 88 on the off lane Faceless Void. Trying to give the reworked hero another chance now. While
it's still very strong.
The 5-man smoke movement from top 5's coming in. Flyer's going to go towards that middle lane as the Brewmaster. He's already rushing up for the bottle. And the Whisper's not for the first time in a very, very long time rushing for a bottle.
30 seconds to battle.
And again, you can always just have the Brewmaster buy it for him. Derp Derp. They need shackles. The movement speed. They're trying to get him range, and they got him. That was a no boot Shadow Shaman catching up to the VS with Slam. As well as the extra spirit damage, they will take the first blood.
They're getting their wards up to block Enigma too. That was a very interesting smoke again attempt, because if he was like in a different position or just like slightly differently positioned or any other hero really, I don't think they would have killed that. I mean, like you said, no boots, Shadow Shaman, just that was their initiation, running at them. What would have been funny to see is if they did the toss instead on Tiny. And just threw like the Shadow Shaman at someone and then latched them, but I don't know if they would have even had the damage to kill. It was weird.
Hey, if they had the toss from the start, they would have been down to have enough damage. They just needed the extra slow, and it had to be the Shadow Shaman more than anybody else.
Oh, this is a safe lane Tiny.
Yeah.
Typically when you see the Wisp Tiny, you see them do like a dual lane mid, and then you have this Wisp stacking a lot of the jungle, and that's kind of his like catch-up mechanism.
This explains why it's no bottle Wisp in this game. And it's a bottle rush Brewmaster in mid.
Yeah. Wisp is just like trading hits with a double damage.
No!
He's gonna be dead.
Oh, Avalanche! He's
fine now.
Body block, a small body block, and now they may even try and turn the shackles into IX Mike 88. He doesn't have time to walk away. The DD is still there. He's turning and he's trying to go for it again. He realized he was dead, so
was
he may
smart,
as well give it a shot.
Man, that Wisp though, that was ballsy. I think going bottle, like I said too, you were saying he didn't rush it, but still getting at some point in the game could still be good, especially if he gets early gold from stuff like that. But yeah, trading hits with a Void in melee range as a Wisp when he has a DD rune, probably not going to end up like that for you most of the time. Would not recommend that.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily for him, they happened to get the kill that time.
At least the Ice Mike 88 wasn't lose out in the experience on the top
lane. The die farm strat, very good.
I'm not classing
it as. Not optimal, but it's better than not getting him either.
True.
They're going to have a hard time zoning him out too, I think, with their heroes, because as long as he doesn't do greedy stuff like that, and he saves his time walk, until the Tiny gets like a lot of... I guess once the Tiny gets some levels, it can actually just blow him up. It just depends on his backtracks. What's going on here? Oh, they're checking the runes. Getting the bounty rune. I don't know why they have both people coming to check the bot rune.
Safety first.
It's an illusion.
It's actually surprising how much experience that thing gives.
It's really big, honestly. Like, for the first couple of levels, I really don't know why they didn't have someone from top 5, like, competing for the runes. I think the first, like, 3 or 4 rune controls are going to really set the pace of the game for most lineups. But luckily for them right now, Whitebeard is, like, getting destroyed in the jungle, so they can afford to be a little inefficient.
The amount of experience which IX Mike just picked up then almost looked equivalent to him just leeching the experience off this pull point.
Yeah,
because he went up by almost half a level. It's sitting from level 2 and a bit, and now he's actually dragged the creep wave down. So this will be his third level available. And Derp Derp's trying to have a crack here in the bottom lane up against Shanks. So magic missile, Sunstrike's going to hit correctly. Need a little bit more damage than what they've got, however. And the full face boots aren't completed on the invoker, so he didn't have the movement speed and the damage to keep up with him.
Or they needed cold snap, and he wasn't capable of getting that yet.
He's only level 3 invoker, he put everything he had into the Sunstrike.
This Elder Titan's actually getting a lot. He's doing a good, I mean, he's kind of low now, so he's sort of in danger zone. He's run out of regen. Getting a bottle on Elder Titan would be crazy good now, obviously in the offlane. Oh, derp derp, nope, not going to get it.
That Enigma now with his Soul Ring up and running.
Yeah, it's really late though. He still has his camps blocked for another, actually, no wait. That one's going to be done. They're both going to be gone. So he'll have on 4 minutes, he'll have his whole jungle back.
Yeah.
Except for the...
Just the pull point. Because you've already got the Observer Ward down for that one as opposed to the two sentries. But they could try and force out that bottom lane. It's like Fly's having himself some fun in mid. Sending his all 3 bottle charges and then go pick himself up a rune. And bring himself back to full life again. TC's making the break for the top rune. And this is, again, like, it's good rune control. Whitebeard comes down to look for the bottom one. And TC and Ix might get EA control the top. And Shanks, well, he wants to have a go of this, but it's going to be a haste rune on the bottom. So a little bit of harassment damage. He goes into the pit. Just trying to juke him in the fog of war. And up to the high ground. So it's just chip harassment coming into him. There's a Malivistun available, but there's no reason to overextend himself. It's just chip damage, as long as the Drunken Brawler stops blocking it. And that just means another rune in for TC. So bottle charges and the experience. This Death Prophet is actually rapidly approaching level 6.
Yeah, he definitely is winning mid lane. Those denies add up. But it's not as significant as it was last game, I don't think. So Flame might be in trouble if he goes for a Sinistra. Actually, he's just diving him.
He needs one attack and then the Crypt Swarm attack. And don't have that attack dodged by Drunken Brawler. But he had 3 points up in the Crypt Swarm. That was 250 damage. With one attack, that should have been enough for a kill. But he backed up after being slowed. Now, he also had the Sound Strike available at any point.
Yeah, so I was expecting that too. But the Shaoshan's roaming on mid here. This could potentially be a kill. They don't have vision of it right now.
Well,
he's playing really aggressively. Yeah, he's got him.
The shackle's up. Fly, where's your Sunstrike? It's coming in, but Fly's already being over, like, he's chasing the hero. It's exactly what he should be doing.
Yeah, I don't know. That was just sort of like, hey, I'm dying mid, help me team. He's like, I'll throw a Sunstrike at them. But if anything, you probably want to throw it on the Shadow Shaman there to make him maybe hesitate a little bit. Because I don't think the Panda's going to be too afraid in that situation. But the Shadow Shaman, if you hit him, he might be like, oh no, what if someone comes in like from the TP that could kill me? And I don't know. He's still going to cast his nukes at the very least. I just think that hitting him, it's like a more guaranteed Sunstrike too, because obviously he's shackling. So it's not like you're going to miss that one.
Ix Mike 88 is so just wanting to kill off this Wisp. He's attempting to do the pulls all the time. And Whiskey's taking a lot of damage from the Centaurs when he tries to take the aggro off it. And Mike, with the Observer Ward's watching the Wisp's life points very close, he knows he's got no regeneration. So if he leaps in, and there's no easy tether target, and the Tiny's not going to bring in help straight away, they actually gave him a shared Tango so he's got more life points. But with a slow and a potential time lock, you could actually just snipe the Wisp out solo.
Yeah, he has to get like the super lucky instant bash when he tethers, but it'll be a kill if he does that, otherwise he'll probably get away.
Shaman has an Invis rune in the mid. They're just going to walk up. Clap him, and they'll have to use the split as well if they want to get this kill, and there she goes. TC doesn't have silence leveled up, so it's just an easy stun. In the meantime, this Storm Brulee can move over and go after Derp Derp, but... Oh, they will survive long enough with these spirits. Yeah, look at him go. Send Derp Derp up into the air. The Earth Brulee's too far away. He's already backing the crap out of town.
He's close to a blink already. Like, those two kills were gigantic for him.
How much did he get from it? 254 and 263.
Yeah.
Where's the gold? It's still 4-0. The overall advantage is still only 300 gold, however. It's 300 net worth, because I suppose we still have to take into account the Enigma is farming the jungle. Now, there's a toss in. There's that combo you're talking about
cute.
Before. Easy shackle onto Ix Mike 88, and he couldn't time walk himself away. He got control up there by the Tiny. That's what double avalanche stuns were for.
And they're trying to kill this Panda mid now because it slits down and maybe push off of it. But is he going to evade this? Are they smoking for it? They did smoke. They do have Black Hole. They have Buckler. Enigma doesn't have boots though, which means that they're going to try and have... Actually, neither of them have boots. So if the Panda is... If they just miss time this just a little bit and go on him in an awkward position...
They'll have to go around the back.
They can also break through the trees. They actually want to do that. They're trying to like hide in the trees here and then break out with Midnight Pulse or something.
The smoke just broke. Here they come. Magic missile, it's going to connect. Are they going to commit the hole? Yep. Fly, drags right back in again.
And then they're going to ult off this, maybe?
Yep, yeah, there she goes.
He's at the very least going to get some damage, maybe even take the tower. They have Eidolons too. Yeah, I don't know. The Panda, I think that was sort of a slow reaction. He should have seen all his trees above him just instantly die and be like, I'm running away from that.
There's a nice dump up here by Shanks, but it's not going to stop the push because now the army of conversions is created. It's wasted half the time of the exorcism, however. But there's no reason why. Okay, maybe there is a reason now. The Shaman's coming in, and with 3 points up in either shock, one of the conversions will go down. But the Invoker's still getting a lot of space to farm up on this bottom lane. He's uncontested, 58 for 29, as far as the CS goes, and he's almost neck and neck with the net worth of a Tiny, who's walking around with 102, and that was his first blood kill as well. So bonus gold from that.
And he has two assists, so yeah. He's definitely out farming him with the Midas and stuff, but I mean, as the game gets later, Tiny will definitely accelerate much more than Invoker will. But letting Invoker get these early levels, he can definitely become quite a force to be reckoned with. They picked it earlier today, too. They've been running the safe on Invoker quite a while.
We're going again. TC walked into the Shackle. There's no one to support, but again, we'll go for Clap, instant split, and the follow-up picks. He's got no mana for an Aether Shock, still short by 20 gold. The Earthbrooming Sun will fly, but TC's a long way back already. And top 5, I don't think they're really feeling comfortable about being this deep in, but Brumar's like, well, I've come this far. I may as well try to go the whole way. The Sunstrike's looking for a pickoff, and it's going to find it, too. Hits and allows Derp to get the follow-up kill into Mercy, please.
Yeah, I don't know why he's trying to get the kill without his ultimate. Like, I'm... they should have had it, actually, though, to be honest. He missed Micro the Pandas there pretty hard a few times, and they kept, like, running back and forth, and TC was able to wait because of it.
Sunstrike's coming back off cooldown, and I'm seeing IX Mike 88 with a Chrono. I don't think he can kill off the Tiny on the top lane, but the Wisp, however...
very easily. Yeah, I think it's going right now.
Yep. Leap it up and just Chrono. Leap, Chrono, Sunstrike, easiest hit ever. One hit. There he gets it.
He might die for that, though.
He's got Time Walk away in 4 seconds' time. How much damage has Patsol got? And how much can he backtrack? The Hexes, secondary toss as well. And he triggered a Drum Charge, so he's capable of getting there in time. This derp. I'm still trying to come to terms with just how far in or out of position you are when you move around this bottom lane. Because once you bring down the T1 tower, you seem to get this very easy access to loop yourself around and always contest Ancients. Like, really, really easy access. Even over towards that side shop. It's like top 5 approaching the bottom lane. It's just so damn difficult now. Maybe it's just me. Maybe it's probably just me.
I think it's actually harder to contest the Ancients now, because it's like you don't have to have the ward vision to see people coming towards the Ancient Pit. So before, if you didn't have vision over the rune, I mean, typically you would, but sometimes you won't. If you don't have vision like over the rune, you can't see them coming. But now if you're on the dire side, you can see them coming from like far away. They can't just like run up the hill and be right on top of you. And then same thing goes for the other, like coming around the other side. Instead of just running around the top corner, there's a pretty, like, I guess it's actually easier if they come from the top side now than it was before, probably. Yeah. Because before you would just run around that like little ledge that was, you know, right at the very like tip of the tier one tower, and you just go right around and there'd be someone farming ancients right there. But now it's like they'll actually be in that little cubby. It's much more similar to the Radiant side now, though, I believe, in terms of like the same sort of things, how it works. One side you can see them coming from a long ways away, the other side if they like do a wraparound gank, you're not gonna see them coming.
The difference is one's got high ground, one's got low ground. The Radiant have a high ground, where Dire have the low ground.
You have like high ground. The high ground is the wraparound gank that you'd be like, they'd be coming from way around, like wrapping around from the tier two, or like running all the way up the lane. But if they do the low ground one, it's like you can see them coming up through there. You'll see them hopefully like right here or something. Or I guess I can't draw for some reason.
I would look at your drawing, but right now I'm currently looking at a wonderful artwork by IXMike88.
Yeah.
He's the color purple tonight. So we're going to try and go again after the lag will wear off.
So Wisp is going Silvering, which is kind of interesting.
It's going to be the Crimson Guard. It's going to be the Crimson Guard out from him.
On the Wisp. Soul Ring... Crimson Guard is the Vanguard,
Isn't it Vanguard and Soul Ring?
It's Vanguard Buckler.
You're right, it's Vanguard Buckler. Soul Ring is... It's the Bloodstone. It's the Bloodstone change.
I wasn't sure, but I think, yeah, that's right.
Yes. Yes, it is. I just double-checked my side screen. I can't believe because I talked it out, the Crimson Guard, before we even started this game. Just to reiterate what the hell it was.
And Nygma went mech, which is the standard thing. And like I said, in this situation, mech is better, for sure, because it's a lot of magic burst damage, but I could definitely see Crimson Guard being a good substitute for that in certain games.
The mech right now is just so his team is capable of fighting early on. The Crimson Guard's nice, but you kind of want to have both. You can't just have one or the other.
That's true.
Actually, you need it for your team fight. Chrono's coming off cooldown in 2 seconds' time. But there's also three heroes waiting on this top lane. They just tossed the Shaman in, but Mercy, please, is in range of that tower. If he can get this Chrono off, which he can't. Oh, he can! Sunstrike is trying to hit only on Mercy, please. It's a little bit far off. The Crypt Swarm attack, and in comes Mike. Revenge is granted. Two heroes lost for top five on the top lane. While now, the Blink Imp, the Split, Mike's into the corner. 3 seconds until he's got jump. Backtrack, swap over, and then leap himself away to safety. The VS stun just trying to slow up the damage dealing Brewmaster, which has been brought down by TC with that double damage rune. So he's lost the damage there while on bottom lane, the Black Hole catching out Shanks. The Spirit will come in at the same time he dies. So 6-6, very quick consecutive kills.
Yeah. That was a really awkward use of the panel.
Oh, it's a really okay game coming in bottom lane. We'll go back to what I'm laughing at later on, and Invoker will go down. Natani able to claim that kill. Look at the experience from three kills. Look at the experience graph. That just shot up in the air.
Yeah, that is a lot. To be fair, though, those were pretty farmed heroes. Let's see.
In comparison to like the level difference, it didn't really seem that much. They didn't get the tiny.
What's more crazy is like the single return kill on the Invoker swung it back another like 1,000 gold and 500 experience. Like usually that would barely be. I mean, it would be a lot, but it wouldn't be quite that much.
Yeah.
All right, so Tiny is actually really close to Eggs. He needs his Blade of Alacrity. Once he gets that. Should expect to see them trying to push some more towers, especially the tier ones.
And if they're about to go on, I think they were considering a relocate gank to bottom, but that's not available just at the moment. TC's just trying to creep swarm the wave down. But Shadow Shaman with the Master Open was looking to the T1 tower in the top lane. The Nyx Assassins boys were looking for a gank up on the bottom lane. But then again, so was Fly and the Shaman, that's why he just bailed out of there. Attack. The rune control is getting a lot better though for top five. They're at least able to pick up like between the runes. Well, the Elder Titan took the Haste rune, the Bounty rune was taken by the Brewmaster. So they're controlling up a little bit more. And the Mask of Madness now completed for Ike's Mike 88 with his treads. 14 minutes in. So at least he's pumping out a little bit more damage when it comes to these engagements. And TC's cracked level 11. So his ulti's also going to be doing the work during the fights. Speaking of which, Nyx Assassins, it's smoke time.
Oh no, if they go for that toss. Okay, I was gonna say, if they go for that Rasta toss combo again, they're gonna be sad. They did ult for it. These wards will probably just end up dying off. They're trying to bait them in, but they might end up.
See if they go for it. There's a smoke. They're moving up. Malivus done over on the Tiny. The Master Serpent Ward's almost all gone, and Mike gets a double chrono. Sunstrike's gonna go onto the Tiny, and that will be guaranteeing the kill. And with the Exorcism triggered by TC, they're gonna move up, kill off that Wisp with the Mask of Madness being triggered. Ike's Mike 88 will take a double kill here. And they're just going to take the T1 tower on the top. TC can tank it up. He'll get his life points back anyway from the Exorcism. Dire's top tower is under attack. And they'll try and
force
it out.
They're actually defending with Elder Titan and Pandal, which they probably can.
Radiant's top at the same time, though, the top tower is now going to be denied. The T1 tower in the bottom lane was already taken by Sneaky Nyx. And the T1 tower in the middle lane is also forfeit. So Nyx will be happy. Like, Sneaky Nyx will be very happy with how much they've taken. They pushed their net worth advantage up to about 6,000. And their experience is also climbing rather rapidly up to about 4.2k their way. So, back to farming, but you can have a little bit more time. The Enigma has actually got 2.2k gold in him. Now we'll start to see if it's going to be a Blink Dagger or a BKB. Or well, technically both. Why can't it be both? Or it could be also our new modified Vanguard, the Crimson. It could be. It's a Blink Dagger. Is under attack. I'm feeling the mindset change of Enigma. And I like it.
Let's see. Tiny finishes Ags, right? Or he's bearing it to himself as we speak. They have Mechanism up on the other Titan. He's on the Courier.
Yeah. The team fight is definitely good, but the ability to still eat through them is pretty damn good as well. TC, well, they need their stun over on the Fire Brewling. before that one flies out. Derp, derp. He's in range, so Whitebeard can swap out. They took out the Fire Brilliant. The Storm Brilliant is going to follow up this one, and the Earth one bail out as quick as they possibly can. There is going to be Blink Dagger into the Malifestun, but at the same time... Oh! The Blink to the hole! Because he knew he'd just blink himself out in the way to safety. The stun will come, and Wisp, he was looking for a relocate save there. But now he's going to tether himself away. The attacks are following. TC and now Chrono from Mike. The relocate won't last long enough. Whitebeard blinks up to a nice position. The Sunstrike well out of position. But the the stun's coming in from the magic missile. And sure, the kill, we go 11-7. And TC never even had to use Exorcism, and they took three kills on that one. And they can also take the Tier 1 tower and look to push into the Tier 2. With no Exorcism being used, they could force the issue. They have, however, used Chrono and Black Hole, so...
Yeah, but... I mean, top 5 use Pandol, so... That's one of their main fighting abilities. That was such an awkward jump. This panda keeps doing really weird, jumps.
He's getting too many time locks. He's getting too many time locks of the Sunstrike won't be able to connect, and Shanks, he's going to go for the... He got stomped halfway through, he stopped, and he gets another one! Mike pulling the lockout, but now not. He's in a lot of trouble. Spirit attack, and in comes the Brewmaster with 4 points up in clamp. And Ice Mike 88, support was too good from top five.
That was a little greedy. He should have known that he had a mech up still, and otherwise it would have been worth it, but he's going to pick up a bounty rune on him too.
Radiant's 3 bottle charges to go with it.
Well, top 5 has been taking some pretty bad fights and not really focusing on stacking or farming enough this game, so it's really like been hurting them, but they still can definitely like turn things around because of the current changes to the net worth and stuff, like the kills and the experience gain when you get those kills. So it just depends on if basically Nyx will give them away. If Nyx plays really like well and does not give away any kills and just sort of farms up and then snowballs on the Death Prophet when she gets her next item and level 16, I think they'll be in a really good position to win this game. But if top 5 can get a few good pickoffs and sort of swing the gold and experience back in their favor, then they have a good chance still. Like that Death Prophet, he was looking at going mid, but looks like he's going to go top instead. Ike's Mike does have Chrono up as well, so that they're trying to catch this with Tiny with this Invis rune, which they might be able to. They should know that the Wisp is trying to like bait and relocate out. Tiny should just abandon that. Okay. Oh my lord.
Oh, Mike wasn't really prepared for that. The Sunstrike, he's trying to dodge it out. The old work. And TC, Yule set up buying himself some time. The Creep Wave is tanking up a lot of that Exorcism. And now Patsol, the double kill. Derp, derp. He'll be held in position long enough. The VS goes down as a triple kill. In for Patsol. Give this man some money.
Oh my. So that is 3,400 gold. He didn't have very much before that. And that's the changes in work right there. But yeah, that was so ballsy of him to like try and not just abandon the Wisp, because he kind of leapt on the Wisp and he could have probably ran in the trees and lived, but he actually just like blew up Mike before he did anything. He just popped his Master Madness, and he was trying to go for the double Chrono, but he didn't have vision of them, and he just couldn't really get a good position for it right away, so he hesitated, and as soon as he hesitated, Patsol's like, I'm gonna murder you, and beat him to death with his tree.
And that's gonna be most of his Assault Cuirass if he wants it.
Yeah, I'm interested to see who he's gonna go.
I'll assume just because of the team fighting, we're looking at AC.
Yeah. Especially since he has Elder Titan to like get rid of natural armor.
He bought Yasha. And we're gonna relocate gank. They're coming top lane. Ix Mike 88. He's gonna get almost bragged back in. Now they'll get their double Chrono with the Wave of Terror, beating on the Wisp to make sure Patsol remains here. And Ix Mike, he is not fighting that Tiny.
They are chasing though, and they have a Yule Scepter Death Prophet. They have Black Hole on their Enigma right now.
She's gonna get the silence right. No avalanche, no stuns, but Shanks trying to do it with the Spirit, keeping Derp Derp out. Whitebeard. And he won't commit the Black Hole, just killing off Patsol now. The Sunstrike's on the way in. But the kill already came the way of the Enigma, and Shanks is already backing himself off the top lane.
The reload kickings are super dangerous. Like, that's what I'm saying, these greedy plays from them.
There's a Brewmaster split. They go straight for the kill. He's already triggered the mech charge off. The CP support's coming in from Ice Mike 88. He'll be sent up towards the air, but Enigma's got space. He's also got, well, he's got Sol Ring and Blink Dagger. The both of which he probably won't use here. And Mike realizes just bringing down a couple of these guys. Mass Effort Ward's also now down. They'll have to fortify if they want to hold onto this tower. Actually, got double fortification. One for the bottom lane, which is being pushed out by Necro units right now. And the other one, they're trying to go for the denial. Not possible. Shaman's wards actually come out on top.
Mike finished up his Maelstrom, so maybe advise it. It looks like TC's going for Shivas, I would assume. Which is pretty good against the Wisp Tiny.
You've already got your level 3 book over on Invoker.
Yeah. Enigma's working for that BKB now, which I think going that blink first, a lot of times, sometimes you would see people go, the pretty standard build was BKB into blink just because it gave you really strong pushing in early game teamfight, but now with like the changes and I think you said just with like trying to get the more like early game pickoffs, blink can be really useful. Like we saw at that top fight where he chased with it, I think they wouldn't have killed the Tiny without it.
Yeah, they wouldn't have killed that Brewmaster on the first engagement too. Blink dagger went to work straight away. Radiant's
bottom tower is you just have to be more intelligent about your positioning, obviously.
They're coming into mid. Shanks, Malibu stun. Support's going to go on the other way, though, because the Chrono's over on the Brewmaster. Going to definitely blast him down, and he does take a fall while in middle lane. The Yule's sending Shanks up and towards the air. Magic missile stun. He's on the edge of the Midnight Pulse, but the Mage Charge still available. Whitebeard blinks in after the kill. Well, there's a mentality change. Mercy Plea is going to force him back out of the tier 3 tower, at least. They want to go high ground? They're keeping the backdoor regeneration off cooldown. And Pantsol, now Avalanche, Mage Charge quickly and move the hell away from that Tiny. There's just nothing that can save you from that. But the Wisp and Tiny are coming out again.
Yep. Oh, what the heck? That's interesting. What? Picked up a Reaver. Yasha Reaver, that's pretty unique. I think he's thinking he wants more survivability, obviously, but it's like, I don't think it's Satanic. I think you actually go hard over Satanic in this situation. But then again, they have like tons of lockdown for Fuo Satanic, but then
have
they have
Wisp.
Black Hole. Yeah, and also they have like a Midnight Pulse from Enigma, which is just percentage based, so getting like tons of HP like that in general, not that good. And armor is actually incredibly good against the Sneaking Assassin's team.
Yep.
I think the Manta AC would have been really good this game, or like Yasha AC Manta, something along those lines. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. They did pick up Roche, though, and he gets an Aegis, so I mean, he is very difficult for them to take down right now. If they can take like a good team fight off of this, so now they have the Aegis to back up their team fight, and then they have their Sneaking Assassins has this huge advantage. So if they can take like a big 5-man fight off of the back of the Aegis, it'll basically swing the game back to even in terms of like gold and net worth, or not gold and experience, whatever. So I think this is where the team that has the Aegis is going to be aggressively looking for pickoffs. They did just smoke under this ward though, so I expect should be okay, but maybe he won't be. They do see him farming this. They have a blink on Rasta too.
Relocate. The blink out from Mercy means that he just shackles and holds him there with the Mask of Madness turned on. There's a full amplification of the damage coming out from top 5.
I think Shadow Shaman smoked like right under this ward right here, because the ward was up here for like 5 more seconds and it just went away. But yeah, that's unfortunate.
I would say maybe he's getting tired in the late night, but or early morning, but it's actually like perfect time in America right now.
It's 11 for him, which is pretty late, but I think that's the middle of the day for X-Mike. He's
11?
Late.
It's 5 a.m. here, man. You can't say 11 is late. 5 a.m. in Berlin. Like crap.
Well, that's early, right? Well, or have you been up the whole time?
Yeah, well, unless you've been up since like 10 a.m. in the morning. Yeah.
True. Well. Alright, Death Prophet working her way towards... I'm assuming he's just going to go hard. Like, that's still the standard build. He does need extra HP, so like right now he can actually still get bursted down really, really hard by like... If they do the tiny combo on him with like one or two other nukes, it's going to obliterate him. Someone spam's steaming me one sec.
Good luck, man. Good luck. Alright, so Shadow Shaman starts prepping up the defensive aggressive wards out. I mean, you do actually have this aggressive ward already now down for Sneaking X Assassins. So one big hell of a cliff top, and seeing everything on that bottom lane as far as the movement from top
Radiant's
5.
Top tower is under
you got also Akuro delivering up the heart now,
it's
so it's a full heart for the Tiny and 3.2k life points. It just seems like Pat Sol. I was going to say Pit Lord at the start. I'm like, but no. Put his name
don't
together. Don't
get everyone's hopes up.
Yes. We all would like to see that hero. Please.
That's okay. I'm content with
the only
changes.
One left? Like, the only real hero left, like, the only Warcraft 3 original hero before all the weird-ass change heroes which came out after.
I don't actually know.
I'm not kind of like those two, three new ones that came out after Dota 2 was released. And again, they did bring in Phoenix, so...
I feel like there's, like, at least one other one that I can't think of.
Yeah, there is, it's one which you never really remember his name. Because no one ever played him. Because he came to Warcraft 3 after...
Tiny's actually pretty overextended. He does have the Aegis, though. They're kind of baiting it, but... they Stinging Assassins do have vision of all these heroes just, like, standing behind Tiny mid, so it's kind of a half-hearted bait.
Problem is he keeps losing against Creep Wave, so he can't just fall
out of tower.
They're
going to smoke right under this ward, I think, if they're doing a smoke. Yep. So Stinging Assassins should know that they're in Viz right now.
There was no ping coming out from it, though. It's just... this dire Creep Wave's also going for a bit of a wander. Looks like it was chasing an illusion north. No real hero. They're going to smoke and come bottom lane.
They're baiting him out, though, because they know that... they're a little far back, though, to be baiting this. Oh, man, they're actually backing up, like, right when they're about to go.
Yep. In comes Mercy.
Oh, no.
The Hex will come first. Ush. Four staff away. The Brewmaster split will happen, and Whitebeard... well, the Master Open wards it down, and Mercy, please. The Meg Charge will come out from the Elder Titan, but then IX might get E8. The Chrono, he's able to move up to Shanks. He's still, however, dying pretty quickly to those Master Open wards. Derp Derp looking to actually lend some aid. He's got swap available. While Whitebeard... Black Hole, you got two of them together! I don't know why they walked in! But they just, they like going towards Black Holes. Right now, it'll be a kill onto the Tiny. A 4-0 wipe at the moment. The reincarnation will bring Tiny back to World of the Living. An Avalanche Tosh should kill off Derp Derp. The Fly is still going down to the Urn Tick Out charges. And now they're trying to back up. The 4-star Fat evades the Avalanche. There's Cold Snap. Malifaux still on cooldown for the moment. He's tossing him around, then the quick swing. They've got to keep carting him out to all the sides. Blink over. He's attacking up against Ghouls at the moment. Whitebeard, careful of your life. Tornado up the end of the Yule Scepter. Then the Crypt Swarm. They're able to bring him down. They get the kill. And only lose the Vengeful Spirit in the process. A nice little bouncing around the Kite Boss of the Raid Boss.
Yep, that's what Heart gets you. You got to get kited for like 20 seconds while you just fly around. And the Wisp is so squishy that he just like instantly blew up and they couldn't really... do anything to save him. Shiva's did a lot of work there against the Tiny. He was just like relocating the back. TC just Yules and Shiva's and kited the Tiny for the whole fight. That was kind of an awkward gank. I mean, you don't... that like, if you blink initiate on someone like that with the, what the Chao Shaman did, and he didn't even have vision of it, like, I'm surprised Ush didn't even react to that. He could have actually probably stopped even getting initiated on and just killed the Rasta straight up, but it actually turned out in their favor probably more that he got gone on because they ended up getting that huge fight off of it, so... actually... oh yeah, but
yeah, they get a nice advantage from it. They push up
a huge advantage.
About 16,000 experience gain right now, and about just over 12,000 in the net worth by getting these. Fortunes change. At the same time, we should flag if Enigma dies, he's worth some decent money. So 4-0 is 9 Enigma right now. The only man on the map not to have died yet. He came pretty damn close. I thought he was going to die at the Ghouls when he blinked over them, and he jumped next to the Ghouls with only 150 life points.
Yeah. Usher's about to finish up a Sheepstick. Whitebeard, not really close to any items. TC, I think he's buying his heart right now. Yeah, he has his recipe on the courier already.
Mike just corner the ground in the bottom lane. I assume Shadow Shaman able to blink himself away in time.
Yeah, I think he went for that.
Mike still doesn't have this Maelstrom up and running yet.
He opted to go to the BKB first, which is probably fine. I mean, they needed it so he could jump in and, like, sort of... basically, he got blown up by that timing, that one-time top, and he's like, I don't want that to happen anymore, I think.
We have a crack at this. Silence, Yule Scepter up. Well, relocate out.
Yeah.
They thought that it's going to black hole him, but this just means that the Wisp will die. There's no one that can help him out here. 3, 2, spirit damage, whatever he's got. But the ice path is already going to go down there. Death Prophet with the last hit means she can buy her full heart now. Actually a little bit more cautious with that courier movement. Brought it up, then dragged it straight back down again. Didn't keep it up next to the side shop. It's not as though it was delivering any items, I think it was just they were worried about it.
Top 5 is potentially going on X-Factor here. They actually have... oh, alright. Mm-hmm. He does have... no, he doesn't have BKB up. Why didn't he use that? He must have gone jump 30 or something.
It's probably when he jumped on the bottom lane. Actually, no, that was a while ago now. That wasn't that time ago.
Yeah. I think they tried to go on him, and then he BKB'd and got away, and then they like tried to turn around and go back on him, but yeah, he was aware of that. They just picked up another gem. Mm. Fly has Boots of Travel now as well. I mean, they do have a Tiny, and he's farmed, and if he can get, like, two more items, and then they can start winning some fights with his really, like, farmed Tiny, and the other heroes will get a lot of gold experience out of that, and it'll really help them, like, salvage their team game. But right now, they're basically all relying on the Tiny. I don't really know. The other thing is, like, top five, the rest of their heroes, with the item builds they went, don't scale that well into the end game, like, unless they get really farmed. I think the Elder Tiny needs, like, I guess a Shiva's. I don't think BKB is that good because if he gets caught, he's just going to get like blown up anyways. Mm-hmm. And they have the Death Prophet damage and they could really use the armor. And then maybe have the Brewmaster go like Vlad's and have the Tiny go AC or something. But he's already pretty committed to that Manta. I don't know. Their heroes, like I said, don't seal that well into the end game besides the Tiny. So it'll be interesting to see if they can, even with like a swing and golden experience, make a big comeback.
Well, one team fight could change it all for you. It's just if they can get that fight. And maybe that's what all the items should build towards, and Shiva's gun. Yeah, I'd go for that above anything else. And the mana style? I don't know if that's really going to be what he needs during the team fight. I still think this Tiny should finish up his Assault Cuirass. Even if he has to sell his drums for it. Just getting that second armor advantage up against this Nyx Assassin's lineup. But he's just continuously farming up in the jungle. As the rest of Sneaky Nyx, they'll move themselves up, and Ix Mike 88. Well, he'll find BKB, and he's gonna chrono. The Sunstrike should be able to connect on this one. They bring TC over and they commit the no, he doesn't. He moves over to try and go for the Wisp, switches his targets halfway through. Now the stomp. There's no ET splitter. There's just the Wisp and Tiny going down. But they got the slow on Shanks and Ix Mike 88 instant stun. The splitter is on the way, but they're far enough away they won't be affecting Clank. In fact, Whitebeard blinks himself out of it. It's a double kill for Ix Mike 88. The Exorcism wants to use the Master Serpent wants going to pressure this tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. And they're already TPing Hero down. And Mercy Please does the wise thing. Gets himself out. The tornado was on the way. They got a little bit of vision, even though that tornado vision was nerfed a little bit. Radiant's bottom tower. They were still able to scout it out. And, well, the rest of Nyx Assassins, they've gone into Roshan. And they're doing Roshan rather quickly.
Yeah, because heroes are just like more farm now generally than what they would. Like Roshan's would be dying earlier, but now teams are being more careful with the Roshans because it's just really bad to give up a bad fight at Roshan. That fight was kind of awkward. They were just farming and they saw XMX see them and they tried to run away. He's like, it's okay, I'll just relocate you out. And then the Wisp ended up like tethering into the Chronosphere when he was trying to relocate him out, and it canceled his TP. So they lost Tiny because of that. They would have just been like a trade like the other one before, which was just Wisp for a relocate, which is kind of what their goal is. But unfortunately, the Chronosphere was kind of in the wrong, or the right spot, I guess, for Sneaking Assassins, and wrong spot for top five. And he couldn't get it. He could have done it, but he just had to wait a little bit longer on the tether. He had to wait until it was like right about the TP and then just tether. And then as soon as it goes, like while you're flying, it was just a few fractions of a second off where he like hit the Chronosphere and it didn't go. Mm. Tough luck.
Yeah. Tiny though. Now with a
that's 25k gold lead. I want to see like a top five just win a five-man fight and see how much that swings, because it'll be a lot.
They'll have to win a pretty big man. The Tiny could do it. The Tiny could really do it for him. If the Wisp doesn't get sniped out at the very, very start, it's all possible. But the Tiny doesn't really have a huge amount of damage. Like, he's got a nice, fresh 10-second BKB over on him, and that's what he sold his drums for. But he still needs a little bit more damage. I know he's still walking around with 350, and they got a jump. Top lane TC, Enigma. Oh, he can go for the two-man black hole for the moment. The ET splitter, though, is going to cause the problems. And not even required. Death Prophet takes the kill. Brewmaster now going to jump in. The BKB from Whitebeard, allowing him to escape. And that Exorcism they kill off Shaman, they kill off Wisp. There's your black hole over on the Tiny. Slowing him down. The BKB from Mike leaps down. And Patsol will take a fall. The Brewmaster ultimate is actually wearing out. He's running out of Brewmasters, and now he's back into his normal self. But the Exorcism up for the entire length of that engagement. The Elder Titan was the only man to escape from this. But they'll lose the tier 2 town, they lose the fight so heavily. So heavily.
SGG. TC has a refresher coming. Actually, it's in his stash. I think he meant to have it coming, but he forgot to pick up his items or something, I don't know. But yeah, if he had his ult going into their base, they could easily take two Raxes.
He's missing the Perseverance for it.
Yeah, I think he has the money to buy it though, right?
He does.
Because I just saw the courier flying the base and looked at him and saw it in his stash, but then I realized it wasn't on the courier. They're just using it to... I don't know what they're doing with the courier. Oh, getting the gem. Alright. Oh, there's the stalling tactics from Elotriton, but at this point, like... They're just so ahead. This is like where you have such a huge lead that that change doesn't really matter because you can't kill anyone on the enemy team, so you're not going to get any of that bonus experience or gold.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of like what I was expecting to see. These teams that can farm more and they just like keep building up that lead until there's absolutely nothing to do. That's why top 5 was the one that needed to be looking for the fights, because you know that like Singing Assassins are going to try and avoid giving you really bad fights. And they still did screw up some. Like, they were giving away kills here and there. But it wasn't so significant that it really swung the game back in top 5's favor. They just smoked under a ward, but...
I don't think it really matters right now.
Yeah, I think they can actually just run up. They're just kind of waiting. Actually, what the...
Well, yeah, there's that refresher now out.
They have Chrono.
They're waiting for the refresher to arrive over on TC. The Black Hole is also still on cooldown for another 70 seconds. So they're just... Okay, Mercy Please just a little bit too far out. And that Shaman does not last long. Not last long at all. Tiny wants to go. He's going to throw the Titan in. He's waiting for the right time to do it. Now, Brewmaster has done the split. Tiny's walking his way in. The Avalanche will connect on Derp Derp. And now the BKB is Tiny. IX Mike 88. He's trying to beat down the Tiny. It's not enough damage. The ET splitter is a lot of damage. The VS and now the cleave. First kill goes the way. A Tire Wisp tethers up. Enigma right behind him. Straight to the Malvasun. Takes away that Wisp buff up. The Wisp will buy it back because he needs to try and help Patsol out here with the stomp, with the sleep. They're able to at least still bring him down. They try to buy a little bit more space. The Brewmaster dies outside the base to both Ush as well as to Ike's Mike 88. And the push comes to the top tier 2 tower. The refresher orb gets triggered, so the Exorcism for the second time is now used. More stalling tactics, but then TC just moved far enough in front. He wasn't affected by this. With a silence over on Shanks, there's a relocate save up to the high ground. But they still lose top racks. And they've lost mid racks.
Mm.
And the tier 4 towers are going down.
Yeah, buybacks from everyone. This is just, it's over, but let's suicide run on them.
See how much they can get. Whitebeard, BKB. He's just TPing out. Ooh, that damage to Mike. That was a lot of it. Not enough to get the kill.
See, this is just the smart, safe plays that you're going to see from Teens Mori. They're not going to be like, even though there's this ahead, they're, well, next.
Ush turns, he had the silence and the basic attack with the deafening blast meteorite. He gets every single player of top 5. Invoker, he's in trouble. This is a 6-1-16 Invoker. The sentry ward, well, actually just does, sorry, being triggered already. The toss will go, but the chrono controls and fly. He's going to get isolated 4 seconds until split. He's silenced up and stunned up for now. And then Hex swapping back. The black hole is going to go and it holds fly. He couldn't get the split off in time. Mike with a nice chrono, Shanks TP's out on top of a hill spot. Well, that is GG, and Sneaky Nick's Assassins will advance themselves through and play up against Complexity for that final slot at ESL 1 New York to represent America. There's already 3 teams that will be heading there from America. EG, Navi US, and then it's just up to the Sneaky Nicks, or will it be Complexity? Well, as far as the European bracket goes, Cloud9, as well as Secret, have already qualified themselves through, going 2-0 in their qualification matches. And Alliance will have a date with Virtus Pro. And with Virtus Pro, initially the plan was for VP to play their game from China, because they needed to win their game. Obviously, we're only like 13 days away from ESL 1. So they needed to win this early on so they could organize their visas. But they couldn't. They had to play it out. But they've lost. They've lost pretty badly in iLeague. So they'll be coming back to Europe early. So they'll be playing their game on tomorrow night now. So the 27th at 20 CEST. And PR vs. X Game will be playing their game today. In fact, they are playing their match. And let me do my calculation right now. 6 hours and 42 minutes. No, that's not right. 8 hours and 42 minutes. 7 hours and 42 minutes. There we go. Calculation was wrong. It's too early in the morning. And I'll be back to cast that one for you. Bright and early, wide and awake. It'll be wonderful. Fandango, thanks for joining me, man. I'm
happy. Yeah, thanks for having me. They were pretty good games. I think Sneaking Assassins it definitely sort of like found their way in this patch already. I'm sure they'll still have some ways things to do, but you like they've been picking a lot of the heroes that are good at farming around the map and sort of picking smart engagements, like with Nature's Prophet, with Mike the first game, and Invoker in that sort of sense. So should be interesting to see that Cole versus Snaw game. Should be good games.
I'm looking forward to it, man. So for now, thanks for watching, everybody, and I'll see you guys back here for our live stream at 14 CEST.